God always goes for conviction and conversion over condemnation. So let me say that again. If there's ever any hope of persuading a person, of getting that person to convert to who that person should be, God always goes for conviction and conversion over condemnation. God never denounces somebody in such a way that it sets up that person for failure in the future.
We will sing verse 1 and verse 4.
This morning is
taken from the 11th and 12th chapters of 2 Samuel, verses 11:26 through 12:13. The scripture is found on page 273 of your pew Bible. Listen now to this word from Holy Scripture. When the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she made lamentation for her husband. And when the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. And the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came to him and said to him, "There were two men in a certain city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought. And he brought it up and grew it up with him and with his children. It used to eat of his morsel and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was unwilling to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him." Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die, and he shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you out of the hand of Saul, and I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if this were too little, I would add to you as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have smitten Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have slain him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me, and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will rise up evil against you out of your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of the sun. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." And Nathan said to David, "The Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
I noticed that as Lisa was reading this passage for us, that it never mentioned the name of Uriah the Hittite's wife in this particular passage. And if you're not too familiar with the name Uriah, you probably are familiar with the name of his wife, Bathsheba. Immediately before this particular passage is the very lurid tale of David and Bathsheba when their first encounters with one another. And we know the tale, hopefully, so I didn't want Lisa to read almost all of 2 Samuel to get all of that in there. She had a long enough passage as it was. But just to remind you, King David at this time is up high, and he sees Bathsheba down taking a bath, so she's nude, and he's just stricken with her, and he decides he has to have her, and then he finds out who she is, and the fact that she's married. She's actually married to Uriah, who is one of the soldiers under David's command, of course. And David comes up with this plan and doesn't work out the original plan. So then he comes up with a second plan to try to get rid of Uriah, and has Uriah sent to the very front of the battle and sets him up to be killed. And he is killed in battle. That is what happens immediately before this particular passage. And that's why it says, then Uriah the Hittite's wife goes into mourning and she has her time of mourning. And then David sends for her and takes her as one of his wives. He has many wives, but she becomes one. And really, as far as we're concerned at this point, his favorite at this particular time. So that's why the Lord was displeased with David at the very beginning of the scripture reading that we heard this morning. And so then we hear what happens as a result of that. What happens at the very beginning of what Lisa read to us was the Lord decides to send someone to David. And you would think, well, if the Lord's going to send someone, obviously he's going to send somebody that's going to reprimand David and say, you know, you're guilty. You shouldn't have done that. You know, that was bad, you know. And he does send Nathan the prophet, one of the well-known prophets of God at this particular time in history. Nathan, probably one of the best known probably. So, of course, the Lord is going to send him as sort of an emissary speaking for the Lord to David. And the way that Nathan handles this encounter is very interesting. And so I think there's a lot we can learn from this interaction between Nathan and David. And really looking at the example of Nathan, because I'm going to challenge you in this message this morning to be a Nathan and to try to get some Nathans in your life. So I hope you listen carefully to what it is and how it is that Nathan has this interchange with King David. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemed. Amen. So we need to remember also that David, when we're first introduced to him in the Bible, he is a young boy and he is a shepherd, if you recall. So this case, which Nathan brings to King David now, is a case that would have certainly resonated with David, because it's a case about sheep and herds of sheep and having to do with this little young ewe, this lamb that this poor man has. And so Nathan tells him about a case that one little lamb was like a member of this poor man's family and even slept in his arms at night. And the rich man received a traveler. This rich man had, it says, flocks and herds of sheep, but he wouldn't take one of his own herds of, he wouldn't take one part of a herd of his sheep to sacrifice for this traveler. And of course, that was the custom to do, to show hospitality to someone who came in and visited you. So instead of taking any of his herds of sheep, he took the one little sheep that was like a member of the family of this poor man, had it killed, and then prepared for his own visitor. David, being the king, would have been used to hearing cases like this because that was one of the roles that the king had in society at that particular time. Very difficult cases between people would be brought before the king. They didn't have a Supreme Court or anything like that. The Supreme Court was the court of the king. The case would be brought before him, the king would hear it, and the king would make decisions about that. Of course, David's son Solomon, which by the way is going to be a son of David and Bathsheba, David's son Solomon is the famous king that we think of making the famous decisions because he was such a wise person. But this happened with all the kings. Cases were brought before him. So David would have naturally thought that Nathan was just explaining a case before him of what was going on. with this, between this rich man and this poor man, and this poor man's little sheep being taken from him, being killed and given to the rich man's guest, if you will. But David hears this story, and when he hears the story, he is enraged. I mean, it says that he just basically goes off the deep end and throws a fit. And the first thing he says, well, this man must be killed. And then he says, going along a little more with what the law at that time would said, that as surely as the Lord lives, you know, that this man has to pay four times what that sheep is worth. Well, that's what the law would have said at that particular time. But the first thing David bursts out with is, this man should be killed. Well, that would have been extremely excessive. I mean, you didn't put someone to death, you know, for stealing someone's sheep. That just wasn't a part of the law then, certainly not now. That was extremely excessive when David burst out with that immediately. And we really can't explain that by the fact that David was a shepherd as a young boy. You know, a lot of people were involved in that, and you know, were involved in that particular trade and whatever. So, yeah, this may have been close to David's heart at one time, but as a king, as the ultimate judge, he would have known, you know, you don't put somebody to death for taking someone's sheep. That's just too excessive. But that's what he said. He said, this man should be killed. Obviously, David is furious. So it leads us to think, why is David so furious and so enraged about this particular case? Well, it probably has to do a lot more with the timing of the case, because probably David himself, after this whole affair with Bathsheba and Uriah, felt tremendous guilt and remorse on his own part. Dr. Robert Alter, who's an expert on Hebrew narrative literature, says this. I'm going to quote him a couple of times, so this is a quote. Nathan may be counting on the obverse side of a guilty conscience, namely, the anxious desire to do the right thing now. End quote. So, you know, that's sort of interesting, but if you think about it, if you're guilty, if you feel real guilt about something, remorse about something, it makes you unusually upright in all other areas. You want to make sure everything is, you know, you don't want to make sure, you want to make all other areas of your life be as upright and as just as possible. If you know you're really screwed up over here and you're guilty about it, you want to make sure, you know, nothing like that's going to happen in any other areas of life. So this Dr. Alter goes on to say, and I quote him, as king, it was David's obligation to dispense justice and protect all his subjects. But in the affair of Bathsheba and Uriah, David had done precisely the opposite. Now, as he listens to Nathan's tale, David's compensatory zeal to be a champion of justice is provoked. End quote. In other words, because he knows in his own conscience that he's done something terribly wrong, David wants to be a champion of justice now, as he's supposed to be, as the supreme ruler of the people. So he sort of flares with this anger when he hears this case. Finally, last time I'm going to quote it, Dr. Alter says, and I quote, David, by his excessive anger, condemns himself and is now the helpless target of the denunciation that Nathan will unleash. End quote. And Nathan certainly does unleash sort of a wrath upon David, but he does it in a more subtle way. You notice that Nathan started out very carefully. He approached David and said, I just want to talk to you about a case. And he laid the case out, and he knew it would be something that would touch David, probably. And he said, you know, just let me tell you about this. And David said, you know, burst out. First thing he said, that man should die. You know, who is this man? That man should die. Nathan knows at that point that he's getting to where he wants to go with David. Because when David says, you know, who is that man? Of course, Nathan turns around and says, you are the man. You are the man. Now, it was a very shrewd thing for Nathan to do. You are the man. In other words, saying you are guilty of what you've just done, of this terrible act that you've taken with Uriah and Bathsheba. You know, you're the man. You're guilty here. You know, instead of coming in right at the very beginning, Nathan knew David knew Nathan was a prophet of God. Nathan could have come in there with both barrels blazing right at the beginning and saying, hey, you're guilty. That's terrible. You know, you're the man that did something very wrong here. Nathan did not do that at all. Nathan approached David with a very gentle way of trying to get across to him at that point. David was a leader and a prophet of God, and yet he lied. He committed adultery with Bathsheba, and then he committed murder, basically, with Uriah. So why didn't Nathan immediately jump into David's face and say, hey, you're guilty. I know what you've done. God knows what you've done. Why didn't he do that? Not because late Nathan lacked courage. It's because Nathan was truly a prophet of God. And Nathan is reflecting the grace of God in this particular passage. If there ever is any hope of persuasion, God always goes for conviction and conversion over condemnation. So let me say that again. If there's ever any hope of persuading a person, of getting that person to convert to who that person should be, God always goes for conviction and conversion over condemnation. God never denounces somebody in such a way that it sets up that person for failure in the future. You know, it's very easy for us to condemn someone in such a way that it just raises up their defense mechanisms and that there's no way that they're ever going to change. You know, we do that all the time. We condemn people. We say, you know, that's a terrible person. And that's sort of how we come off. But it glorifies God to tell the truth about sin, but it glorifies God even more if you're telling the truth and that person repents and that person changes what they've been doing or who they've been into the person God wants them to become. If you condemn a person in such a way that it makes it impossible for the person to repent, then you yourself are self-righteous. You're not on God's side. You're not a vehicle for the grace of God. Because after all, you know, it does say in John 3:17, most of us can quote from heart John 3:16. But John 3:17, right after John 3:16, says, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn it, but to save it. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save it. The world. And Nathan is sort of following that. He's not condemning David right here at the beginning. He's hoping that David can be saved and continue to be a true servant of God, which he again returns to after this terrible encounter that he goes through. So why did Nathan do it the way he did it? Because nobody sins, particularly big sins, the way David did. Nobody sins without spinning a kind of rationalizational web of really deceiving ourselves and rationalizing why we did this terrible thing. why did we do this wrong thing? And come up with all these rationalizations of why, you know, we were able to do something that was a terrible sin. David is just a perfect example of what happens. And you know, we hear it and see it all the time in the news today. Again, here in the 21st century, we're no different than what happened 2,000 years ago, 3,000 years ago with David. Today, people in power and places of leadership, they have to sacrifice a great deal to do that. I mean, if you're going to be put in a position of great power in any country today, you're sacrificing a lot to get to that particular point. They give of themselves. Many times, particularly in a country like ours, they have no lives of their own. They get tremendous amounts of opposition and criticism. Any leader, any person in a position of power gets a tremendous amount of opposition and criticism. And some of that opposition and criticism is usually false or wrong. But it still goes on. We know that. We see it. We hear it all the time. And because that person in power suffers and sacrifices so much, it's so easy for them to begin to believe that, they're pitying themselves and saying, I've been wrong. Everybody's against me. And they start feeling self-righteous because nobody has to deal with and put up with what they're having to deal with and put up with. You know, nobody else is having to put up with all the stuff that I'm having to put up with, so that when that opportunity comes along for a bribe or for being involved in embezzlement or an affair comes up and that person gets involved with it, well, that person in power says, you know what, I kind of deserve this. With all that I've been going through, all that I've had to put up with, I kind of deserve this. The self-pity, the self-righteousness builds up and just makes it so easy to fall victim to that kind of temptation. It doesn't excuse it, but it does help explain how so many people get involved in that. You know, they get to the point where they say, I deserve this. You know, it's okay. I deserve this with all that I've been through. And then to justify it later or to cover it up later, which is usually what happens in today's society, you know, they say, God, I need to do that for the public good, so that the public doesn't lose trust, in the leadership and the power structure or whatever, because you can't destroy the public's trust. So David, he falls into that same trap. And he's saying, the things I had to do to get Bathsheba, you know, I deserved her. You know, I've been through all of this. I've sacrificed for the people, so I really deserve it. She was my wife. And the fact that, you know, Uriah had to die to get that to come about, that's just sort of collateral damage. You know, he could rationalize that away. Because he's saying the stability of the society is at stake here. You know, we'll take care of this. And, you know, my friends, it's not only a rationalization web that people in power develop when they do something wrong or when they're drawn, tempted to do something wrong, but everyone develops a similar little web of rationalization to rationalize why we did that. You know, why did I do that? And we all come up with that so similar type of web. It may not be to the extreme as people in power, but we all do. We have to rationalize. Or we think we have to rationalize that why we did something wrong. Why did we do that? And if you're the one, if you're the Nathan that's trying to break through the defense mechanisms of that person that has all these rationalizations, if you're going to help try to see the error of their ways, you don't start out by blaming or accusing or haranguing. If you do, your self-defense mechanisms just pop right up. There's a big wall there. And you're not going to ever get through to it. So it's very, very understandable what Nathan did here. Nathan did come in and say, hey, you did wrong, you're guilty, you're the man, right off the bat. He's going to get to that in a very subtle way when David asks, who is the man? He's going to say, well, that's you. You're the man. Think about where you are. Think about what you did and how you put yourself in this place. But he didn't start out, blaming and accusing and say, you're guilty. Why didn't he do that? Because God always strives for conviction and conversion rather than condemnation. Therefore, Nathan was displaying the grace of God, first trying to disarm David so that his shields would come down, so that he actually could have a communication with him and talk about what had gone on in David's life, rather than coming in and condemning him immediately. Later on, Nathan can talk to David bluntly and say to him, yes, you are the man. You're guilty. You did this. This displeased the God, our God. In God's eyes, this was a sin. He couldn't say that at the very beginning with David if he wanted to try to convert David back to a true servant of God. He could have come in there late, saying, you're guilty. Everybody already knew that David was guilty. Why would you come in blasting with that? He had to have an opportunity to speak with David, to disarm him a little bit, if you will, and then have a real conversation with David about what was displeasing to God. So, the question is, should be, hopefully you have, well, Pastor Steve, how do we apply that in our lives? What does that have to do with us? Today, here, October 23rd, 2022. Well, as I said at the beginning, I want everyone to be a Nathan. And I hope everyone can get some Nathans in your life. By being a Nathan, I mean that you may have friends, you may have family members that have some problems, that have some maybe character deficiencies, some things in their lives that is hurting them. And it's hurting other people around them as well. But their other friends are not really willing to talk to them about it. They're not really willing to say anything about that. Well, I want to challenge you to be an Nathan. And be willing to say you are the man or you are the woman. And these are the things that you're doing. But you don't go in there with guns blazing and coming in and condemning them right off the top. You have to try to follow Nathan's example and do your best to not beat them up with words of condemnation, but to have the courage and the shrewdness, because it's going to take some thought. Now, how are you going to do that? How are you going to approach this person? And you've got to have the courage, and you've got to have love, and you've got to have graciousness as you approach this person. But you also have to speak the truth in love and graciousness. And so much love that even though they may not want to hear what you're saying, they won't be able to not hear because they see the goodwill in your heart. They see that you really care for them. They see that you really love them. So, my friends, go be a Nathan. Go be a Nathan to your friends. Go be a Nathan to your family. But also, you need to have some Nathans in your life. Hebrews 3:13 says, to exhort one another daily, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. David certainly was to the point where he was being hardened by his deceitfulness of sin. But that verse, exhort one another daily, what a verse. The word exhort actually means confront. You're supposed to do it daily in a way that you'll be able to recognize your own sins in your own life. The deceitfulness of sin means that the sin in your heart always spins out some self-defense mechanism. It's always deceiving you. It's very hard for us to see our own sins. A lot of times, actually most of the time, because we've already rationalized why we did what we did. And to us, we don't really see that as a sin. Most of our biggest problems and flaws, we don't see them. Our friends and our family members can see them. You think about your friends and family members. Some of their biggest flaws, they don't really recognize those, do they? We don't either. We don't either. So we need to have some Nathans in our lives who are willing to speak the truth to us about who we are, about how we are living our lives. And we need to have those discussions with those other Nathans in our lives and asking them to be truthful with us about how they see us and how we are coming across in our lives. So not only am I challenging you to be a Nathan for your friends and family, but I'm challenging you to make sure you have some Nathans in your life that will do the same thing for you, that will challenge you. Sometimes that happens in a spousal relationship. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes you can't do that with your spouse. But you need to have some people in your lives who are going to be willing to speak the truth in love to you. You need to be willing to allow Nathan to speak to you in your life and not shut them out. Not close them out with your own rationalizations, with your own defense mechanisms that you put up. And you need them every week, every month, and maybe even every day of your life, if you can talk with those people. Say, if you see me doing this, I want you to talk to me about it. Give them permission to talk to you about the flaws that you might have in your life. Hopefully you have some friends like that. And realize that this kind of Nathan stuff that I've been talking about, that we heard in this scripture passage, the kind where you're speaking the truth in love and talking about hard things. You have to talk about, be willing to talk about hard things. You got to give them the warrant to talk to you about hard things as you talk to them about hard things. You know, those kind of things, they don't happen on Facebook. They really don't. Stuff doesn't happen over the internet. The stuff really can only happen face to face. We're sitting down and we're within touch distance of that other person. Maybe we're rubbing elbows with that other person. One of the bad things right now is you can be anywhere in the world and you have all these friends on Facebook and you spend so much time on social media that you don't actually make friends that live where you live, that see you on, if not a daily basis, at least a weekly and monthly basis, that can really see how you're living your life and how you're carrying out the call God has placed on your lives. You know, if you don't have that, if you don't have anyone who can really exhort you daily, as it says in scriptures, then you can be in trouble. It's so easy. We can't see all these flaws that we have for ourselves. So I'm encouraging you not only to be a Nathan, but to make sure you have some Nathans somewhere in your life. Hopefully it's not in California or New York City. Hopefully you have some Nathans right here in St. Genevieve that you can rub elbows with, that you can be in personal contact with, so that you can see what they're doing, and they can see what you're doing in your life. So, my friends, be a Nathan, and get some Nathans in your life. Thanks be to God. All right, hymn of this response this morning is number 184 in your hymnal. It is Thy Word. It is not a very long hymn, so we're going to sing it all. So I'd ask that you rise once again, either in body or in spirit, as we sing together Thy Word 184. join with me in the affirmation of faith in the Apostles' Creed, found in the Lord of this world. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We know we struggle with questions that seem to have no answers and problems that seem to have no solutions. Yet you, O God, are our hope for the world. And it is in this hope that we live and move and have our being. So help us to find ways to affirm all your people. Surely we know that you love us and that you consider each one of us important and to be a part of your great creation. So, our God, we ask you to again help us to be more like Jesus, who came to this earth to show us how to live and respect others. And this morning we want to remember also to lift up those in our congregation who may be sick, who may be hurting in any way. We ask that you give them peace and strength to
face their situations, for all those that we've mentioned by name this day, and for all those who go unnamed, but we carry in our hearts and our minds, we ask that your peace and love descend upon them this day. And God, we ask that you allow us to be those Nathans in the world, the change agents in this world. Give us courage to speak out about our faith, to teach those around us about your love for all people, and to lead by example, showing and speaking with respect to all others. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Once again, you find our offering plates on the table in the back or near the door as you leave. Remember, there are some special offering envelopes if you want to give to the Shop at the Top program, or you want to give a special offering for our food pantry. There are offering envelopes back there that you can use for that. Regardless of what you may feel that you can give to this day, we certainly appreciate the tithes and the offerings, the sacrifices that all make on behalf of the many ministries of this church here in St. Genevieve. So now listen to this blessing of the tithes and offerings that we give this day. Almighty God, we bring before you today our tithes and our offerings. We ask that you bless them. We also ask that you accept them to help further your kingdom on this earth. Use these offerings as well as our talents, our hands and our feet, our whole being, for use in your ministries of love and of grace. It is in your holy name that we pray. Amen. Our closing at hymn this morning is Great is Thy Faithfulness. It's found on page 139 of your hymnal. We're going to sing the first and the third verses of this great hymn of the church. So let us rise one last time, either in body or spirit, and sing together.
Thank you.
so granted so often in our lives. But God does and will provide for us in our lives. I hope you have a great day this day. Remember, you can go downstairs and get half off on everything that's down on the tables, baked goods or books as well. Finish out. We're going to try to take the Presbyterian women over $1,000. Is that what you're telling me? Things down there. So you can still participate if you haven't had that opportunity, or if you did need something else, stop by on your way out this morning. I hope you have a great week this week. We're coming to the end of October already. Hard to believe, but it's been some beautiful, wonderful weather the last several weeks. So I hope you get out and enjoy the weather, even if it rains a little tomorrow, which hopefully it will. We need the rain, we need the water. So hopefully it will. I hope you have a great week. Now, if you remember that wherever you go, that God will always be there with you. Because God is always above us. God is always below us. God is always behind us. God is always before us. God always stands right beside us. And most importantly, God is always inside us to bring us peace and joy. So go in peace this day, my friend.